Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. So this is, yes, amen. This might be, can you hear me? There we go. Can y'all hear me okay? Christ is risen, and we say he is risen indeed. You ready? Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Praise be to God. I am so glad that you are here with us this morning. It is a privilege and an honor, and I pray that you feel at home here at Restoration Church of Sanford. Our slogan is this: we are a home for the broken, okay, and those who are in need of God's unmerited favor, his grace and his mercy. And I'm just so thankful this morning on Resurrection Sunday that Christ's mercies are new this morning. If anybody is thankful for the mercies of Christ this morning, let us just give him a thanks and a praise. And so, as we say on every Lord's Day, to all who are weary this morning and need rest, anybody weary and need rest? To all those this morning who are mourning maybe a loss or a hurt and need the comfort of the Holy Spirit, to all those who have failed this week, this month, this year, and desperately need the strength of God to prop you up. Anybody like that here in the room that needs the strength of God? I know I do. And to all those in this room who have sinned and need a Savior, this place opens wide its doors with a welcome and a message from our risen King Jesus. We're so glad that you're here. This morning, we always start with a call to worship before we go to the Lord in praise of song. And so this morning, I'm going to have Trenton read Psalm 93, verses 1 through 5.
Good morning. Happy Easter. All right, this morning reading out of Psalm 93. The Lord reigns. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord has clothed and girded himself with strength. Indeed, the world is firmly established. It will not be moved. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their pounding waves more than the sounds of many waters, than the mighty breakers of the sea. The Lord on high is mighty. Yes. Your testimonies are fully confirmed. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore. All right, I'm going to go ahead and pray. Dear Lord, Father, thank you for this day. God, thank you for this Easter Sunday. God, that we get to celebrate another day. Father, in you being the center of it, God, I pray that we would remember exactly what the psalm says, Lord, that you are mighty. Father, you are wondrous. God, all we have to do is just look around at all of creation and see how mighty and powerful you are. Lord, scripture says that you breathe out stars, which is an incredible thought, Lord. I can hardly breathe out anything, but you, Lord, you breathe out stars. That is an amazing thing. So God, I pray that we would go into this Sunday morning, Father, with worship of you, because you are worthy of being worshiped, Lord. Not just because, Father, it is something that we do just to go through the motions, Lord, but that we would recognize that you are a mighty, holy, wonderful, righteous God that is worthy of all praise, Lord. And I pray that we would recognize, God, that we are broken and in need of a Savior, God, and you are our Savior, God. I pray in your name, Lord, that you would soften hearts to hear the gospel today, Lord, that you would soften hearts to hear truth, God, that we would be receptive to hear through Arthur, Lord, the message that you want to preach out of the word of God, Lord. I pray in your name, amen.
They stripped him, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and led him away to crucify him. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." From the sixth hour, the there was darkness over all the land. Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split. His body was placed in a tomb cut out of the rock. At dawn on Sunday, the women went to see the tomb. An angel of the Lord had descended from heaven and rolled back the stone. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen."
Amen. Come on, let's stand together and worship this morning, for Christ is risen, and we're going to celebrate him today. Let's turn that music up, Craig. Come on, church, I just need a clap. That's it, like this. Here we go. That's it. We're going to turn it up. I want everybody to sing with us this morning. Christ the Lord is risen today. Come on, church. Sing it with me now. Christ the Lord is risen today. Sing it. Hallelujah. That's it. Sons of man and angels say, sing it. Hallelujah. That's it. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Sing ye heavens and earth, reply, hallelujah. Bless it, church, you got it. Sing it with me now, lives again. Now lives again, our glorious King, sing it, hallelujah. That's good. Where, O death, is now thy sting, hallelujah. That's good. In dying once he all doth say, hallelujah. Oh, where thy victory o'er the grave, hallelujah. Sing this with me now. He is not dead. If you believe it, come on. He is alive. We have his hope. Yes, we do. In Jesus Christ. Love's redeeming work. And love's redeeming work is done. Sing it. Hallelujah. Now fought the fight, the battle won. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. And death in vain forbids him right. Hallelujah. Oh, Christ has opened paradise. Hallelujah. I want to hear you now, church. He is not dead. No, he's not. He's alive.
He is alive.
We have this hope.
And we have this hope.
Yes, we do.
In Jesus Christ,
we have this hope this morning. If you have hope in Christ this morning, let us just give him a shout. Come on, church, let us give him a praise. Let us give him a thanks, for our Christ has risen from the grave. Praise the Lord. Soar we now,
and soar we now. Christ has led.
Sing it, church. That's good.
And following our exalted head, hallelujah.
All right now.
Now made like him we rise, hallelujah. Oh, as the cross, the grave, the skies, hallelujah.
Yes,
he is not dead.
And I want to hear you, church. Come on.
He this morning. Lord, we give you all the thanks and praise, because we have this hope this morning. And all the people of God, just give them a shout and a praise and a thanks, for we have hope in our resurrected Lord this morning. Praise, 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 praise be to the risen King. Praise the Lord.
See, on a hill of Calvary,
yes,
my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. And look at the wounds that give me life.
Yes.
Grace flowing from his side. No greater sacrifice.
What he's done.
What he's done. What he's done. And all the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. For the freedom he has won, even death is dead and done. His life has overcome. Oh, speak, say the name above all names, over every broken place. He is risen from the grave. For what he's done, what he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. Now,
get this picture now.
On a throne of majesty, the Father's will complete.
He reigns
in victory.
He reigns this morning. Praise God.
Now sing hallelujah to the King. And he is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. What he's done, what he's done. The glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. And I praise God for what he's done.
Let's sing that again together.
And what he's done, what he's done. Yeah. All the glory and the honor the Son. My sins are forgiven.
That's our future.
My future is heaven. And I'll praise God for what he's done.
Oh, oh, I praise God, yeah, for what he's done.
Come on, let's give him thanks for what he's done. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Lord, this morning, God, how deep is your love for us? Amen. The Father's love is so deep. And sometimes we just got to hear the voices of the people of God sing without maybe percussion and some of the other instruments, just our voices together. Let us sing this morning.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast, beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. And how great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Now behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulder. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. And it was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life.
Yes, Lord.
I know that it is finished.
Let us boast in Christ.
I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom.
This good verse here.
But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection.
Lord Jesus, we do not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. Nothing, Lord, nothing. We do not boast in anything else. This morning, as we come here on the Lord's Day, we don't boast in anything that we have done. But that's why this morning we have chosen these songs carefully. We want to sing about what you have done. Amen? What he's done. All the glory, all the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. So this morning we come before you, our resurrected King, who is seated at the right hand of the Father, reigning and ruling over all of the worlds, over all the nations. And we come confessing that we will not boast in anything. Nothing, Lord. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But this morning, the only boast we have on our lips, the only boast that we will sing about, that we will preach about, this morning is your death and your resurrection. Lord, we love you. I pray that you're honored in this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can have a seat this morning.
Praise the Lord. I am so grateful to be here with you. The Lord is so good. He's risen today, and I am so grateful. We have this time of our service etched out so that we can pray and thank the Lord. Yes, praise the Lord. We want to pray and examine ourselves. We want to go to the Lord and ask him to work in our hearts and our minds. And the way we do that is we focus on two prayers. One of confession and one of praying for one another. Now we know that the only way that we can even come to God and confess our sins is through the blood of Jesus. And so what he has accomplished allows us to go before him and ask him for forgiveness. We all have sin. We've all messed up. We've all failed this week. My wife's right here. You can ask her. I messed up this week. I heard an amen. We need the Lord. We truly need the Lord. So I ask at this time, we're going to bow our heads, and I ask that you would go to the Lord, examine your heart, ask him to forgive you, ask him to show you places this week where you might not identify where you messed up, and if you need to apologize to your wife, your child, your brother and sister in Christ, I pray that you would take this time to do that. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of the summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer a prayer to you at the time when he may be found. Surely in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from my trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. Psalm 32:1-7. Lord, we thank you for this time of confession. Lord, we're reminded that we need to come to you, that as long as we're in this body of flesh, as you're working your process of sanctification in us, Lord, I pray that we would come to you, Lord, and ask for forgiveness. We understand that when we sin as Christians, we break fellowship with God, and we have to continue restoring that fellowship. You promise to keep us. You promise that our salvation is secure in you, Lord. And so we come to you under the grace of God, knowing that you are a loving and gracious Father. And Lord, thank you for accomplishing for us a freeness from sin, a freeness from the debt that we owe to God, that the wrath of God was poured out on you for our sin. So Lord, I thank you, knowing that when we come before you, not only do you forgive us, but you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In your name, Jesus, I pray and give thanks. Amen. And so this time of prayer, we're praying for one another. We are grateful that the Lord, through his blood, has accomplished for us to be a part of the family of God. We have been adopted into a family we don't deserve to be in. And we've been given an inheritance that isn't ours. And so I ask, as you talk to your neighbors and you ask what you could be praying for, you be reminded that you've been brought into a family by Jesus' blood. And he calls you to love that family. On the night before Jesus died, during the Passover, he knelt and washed his disciples' feet. This was the job of a servant, the lowest of society, the savior of the universe, got down and washed their feet. He said, the greatest of all is the servant of all. And so I pray as you talk to your neighbors that you would serve them in prayer, not just today, but for the rest of the week and maybe even the rest of the year, that you continue praying for your neighbor, interceding on their behalf, because that is one of the greatest things that we can do, a great show of love, that we would constantly go on behalf of that person to the Lord. So if you can, turn to your neighbor. If you want to go across the room to a neighbor who's across the way, but find someone and ask how you could be praying for them. Let's take this time to pray. Thank you. 1, 9 to 11 says, "And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes from Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God." Lord, I ask as we're finishing up praying, Lord, and as we've gone back to our seats and as we're thinking about what we've prayed for our neighbor, God, I ask that you would keep those prayers on our mind as we go throughout the week and even the rest of the month, all to the way to the rest of the year. God, we'd be mindful of these prayers, that we'd be praying for our neighbor. God, that we would wait with expectancy for you to answer the prayer, Lord. And we trust that you will, Lord Jesus. And I pray, God, as we pray for our neighbor, that our love would grow for our neighbor. God, I pray, God, that you would build not only relationships, God, but I pray, God, that you would restore friendships, family members, Lord. I pray there would be reconciliation. God, I ask that you would work in our hearts, Lord. Soften our hearts towards one another, God. I pray this would continue to be a place, God, where your love, Lord, is displayed by your people. God, work in our hearts. And Lord, help us to continue to pray for our neighbor. Lord, I thank you for this time. I thank you for making a way so that we can be adoptive sons and daughters who are grafted in to the promises of God. Lord, we don't deserve it, and we did nothing to earn it, but it was by your grace and your mercy. So, Lord, I thank you. Continue to work in us for the glory and honor of your name. In your name, Jesus, I place all these things before you. Amen and amen. At this time, Kim Nolnick is going to come up and she's going to give us some announcements and pray for the offering.
Good morning, church. Happy Resurrection Day. I don't know about you guys. I didn't grow up this way, but my mom lived with us in her old age, and every Easter morning, she would say, "He is risen." And we would say, "He is risen indeed." So let's do that this morning. He is risen. Yes. I say every time I'm up here that there's no place I'd rather be than with God's people in the house of the Lord. And that's extra true today, right? Because we have been anticipating this day. As a church, we've been in a Holy Week devotional. We had a Palm Sunday service last week. We had Good Friday this week. And this is what we've been waiting for, the day we celebrate our resurrected Lord. Amen. So I just want to welcome you, especially if you're new today. I know we have a lot of guests, and we are glad that you're here. We would love to connect with you. And the best way for us to do that is if you'd fill out the card that's in the seat back in front of you, and you bring that to the table that's outside. We have a gift for you. And I actually brought one up on stage with me because we just made a bunch more of these. And let me tell you, I was blown away. They are so generous. There's a journal in here. Where you can pray through scripture. There's a blank journal where you can take notes. We've got a little book about how to get more out of your Bible reading. There's a coffee cup. I'm not going to pull any more out, but there's a coffee cup. There's a bookmark. There's an invitation for you to connect with us and for us to buy you coffee or lunch. So if you fill out that Connect card, someone will reach out to you. I can guarantee that this week. And they're going to invite you to come to lunch or have coffee with them. So I hope that you'll do that. And also on the back of that card, there's a place where you can write a prayer request. I promise you it will be prayed for if you turn that in. So I also want to let you know that we'd like to invite you on April 23rd, that's next Saturday, to join us at Lee P. Moore Park from 11 to 2. We're going to have a fellowship there. We've got three other churches joining us, Scent Church, Powerline Church, and Safe Harbor Church. So we would love to see you there. We're going to have a catered hot dog lunch, potluck. We're going to have, you don't have to bring anything, but we will. And we're going to have bounce houses. We're going to have shaved ice for the kids. So it'd be another opportunity for us to connect with you, and we would love for you to be there. And next, we're going to move into a time of worship through giving. But before that, because there's so many of you that are new here, I want to tell you a little bit about our church, Restoration Church of Sanford. So we've just started meeting on Sunday mornings in January. So it's only been a few months. But this church has been meeting and serving in this community for the past little bit over 2 years now, I think, right before COVID. And so I wanted to let you know that every Thursday we meet. We have a meeting called Pray for Sanford that's been going on, and we are out serving the lost and the broken and the homeless. We bring a meal out every week. We invite people into a church service. We have a time of prayer. And so it is such a joy to give to this place, because we know that as our giving is going to meet physical and spiritual needs in our community. And we are seeing lives transformed. It is so powerful. It's actually my favorite night of the week. So I just wanted y'all to know that. Also, we're super involved here with Hamilton Elementary School. I don't know if there's pictures up yet, but we just did a garden beautification project here. We love this school. They are good to us, and we try to love on them as well, because we want to be a part of this community. So that's a little bit about our church, and our ushers are going to come forward in just a few minutes, or actually in just about 1 minute after we pray, and they're going to pass the baskets, and that's one way to give. You can also give by texting any amount to 84321, and it'll go, like I said, to meeting physical and spiritual needs here in our community. So if you'd bow your heads with me for just a minute, we will pray over this offering. Heavenly Father, today we praise you for the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Lord, there are not enough words to express our gratitude for his sacrifice on our behalf. I pray, Lord, that as we give today, our hearts would be overflowing with gratitude for Jesus, for Emmanuel, God with us, the one who came and dwelt among us, loved us, and saved us from our sins. Lord, we ask today that you would take these gifts, that you would multiply them and their use as we seek to bring your gospel to the Sanford and beyond. We love you because you first loved us. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sous-titrage Société Radio-Canada. Good morning, Restoration Church. I'm Don. It's great to be here. It's great to see you this morning. Go ahead this morning and turn to John chapter 20 for our scripture reading, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Christ. And to understand that means it's the key feature of Christianity. It's the main event of why we have this faith. Let's read John 20, starting in chapter 1, and we'll go through 29. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together. But the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back in their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped in to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he has said these things to her. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and he said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his hands and the marks of the nails, and place my finger into the marks of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Amen. Let me pray as Pastor Arthur comes. Father, the resurrection event by which you validated the sacrifice of Christ negated all those animal sacrifices over the centuries that could never take away sin. But the sacrifice of Christ removed sin forever on the part of the people who believe. And Father, you indicated that by the resurrection, by ripping the veil in the temple, ending the ceremonial system and sacrificial system at that point, Father, we know Christ is our complete and satisfactory offering. And for that, we rejoice and give thanks this morning. Be with Pastor Arthur as he brings your word. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear. Amen.
This one sound better? Hey, sorry, Don, you had to go through that, okay? Well, welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I hope you guys are excited to be here to celebrate on this Resurrection Sunday. All I kept thinking, even as Don was reading that, was this. And all morning, it's kind of been just kind of percolating in my mind, is that song, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Does anybody know that song? Anybody? It says, all hail, nobody? Okay, one, two. Okay, well, I won't sing it because nobody will join in with me. But it says, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him the Lord of all. Listen, do you get that picture that the angels have fallen down before the King of Kings and they have crowned Jesus, the Son of God, Lord of all? That's our King. This morning, welcome to our Resurrection Sunday celebration service. We are honored. We really mean that. We are honored to have many of you as guests this morning. And I'm just going to challenge you again, just based on what Kim was talking about just a second ago. We're going to challenge you to connect with us, okay? Not just because of what you're going to get in that goodie bag, although that's pretty good stuff. But just because we want to connect with you, we want to come alongside you, we want to come and get to know you. We know that this faith journey thing is not meant to be walked alone. It's not. There are no individual rogue Christians, okay? We're meant to do this together. And now, since we're on the topic of getting to know each other, my name is Pastor Arthur Gonçalves. I won't make you say my last name. We're from Portugal. And my lovely wife, Jessica, she's in the back. Don't leave yet, honey. There you are. Everybody look back and say hi, Jessica. That's my lovely wife, Jessica Gonçalves. And we're going to be married for 14 years on May 10th, okay? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's only by God's grace. And we have four beautiful children under the age of 11. We believe that children are a gift from God, but if you have more than one child, you know we need all the prayers we can get. And maybe that's why Miss Michelle put out these prayer cards. Y'all pray for us, okay? They're not just fans, but we need all the prayer that we can get. Amen. I know for many of us, if we're honest, this is maybe the first time in church for you. Or maybe it's the first time in church in a long time. And I just want to let you know that's okay. That's okay. Please know this, that we are a home, as I said earlier, for the broken. We are a home for those who have not quite got it all right and got it all together. We are a home for those maybe who haven't been to church in a very long time. You see, this place, my dear friends, is a place of restoration. Hence the name, right? Restoration Church of Sanford. It's a place of new beginnings. It's a place where God and His resurrected Son Jesus meets us where we are and transforms where we're going. I don't know, I thought y'all would be excited about that, but y'all can help me preach this morning by saying amen, Pastor Arthur. I appreciate it. I knew Nikki and Brother David would give me some, or help me preach a little bit this morning. But you see, this glorious truth that I just mentioned and all the other magnificent realities and promises made in Scripture, they're really all predicated on one thing. All of that is predicated on one thing: Jesus being alive. Jesus being alive. You see, God's promises to a broken world are not simply predicated on what Jesus did in His earthly ministry, as important as that is, or even on what He did on the cross on Good Friday, as important as that is, but all of God's promises and all those truth claims that are made in Scripture are predicated on whether or not He rose on Sunday. That's the bottom line. If He's alive, which we believe He is, then everything He said is true. If He's alive, which I believe He is, then everything He did on behalf of broken sinners in a broken world has been accomplished. Amen. So the text this morning that Don read gives us an extraordinary snapshot of Jesus' interaction with His disciples following His resurrection. Jesus, before His final ascent to sit at His Father's right hand on the very throne of heaven, leaves his disciples, and he leaves all of us here in this room 2,000 years later with three essential promises that are laid up in these verses, verses 19 through 23. He leaves us with three promises. The resurrected Jesus promises to those who follow him peace. To those who will follow Jesus, the resurrected Jesus promises his followers power. Not only does he promise his followers peace and power, but he promises his followers purpose. Peace, power, purpose. If you ain't sweating yet, you're going to sweat by the time I'm done with my message. Because I know it's hot in here. Forgive us. But I want y'all to say that with me. Peace, power, purpose. Let's try it again. Peace, power, purpose. I've entitled my message this morning, Three Promises of the Resurrected Jesus. And I want to submit to you this morning that these three promises that Jesus made to his disciples 2,000 years ago and are transcending even the disciples, even to us right now, these three promises are what everyone in this room and everyone in the world are looking for at the end of the day. You see, some look for peace in a beer bottle or prescription pills. Some look for power in a career or in their ambitions. And others look for purpose in chasing accolades or achievements. But today, my dear friends, I will show you from the words of the resurrected King Jesus where true peace and true power and true purpose can actually be found. I appreciate you, Jerome, helping me out in the front row. You know, I don't gamble. I don't play the lotto. If you do, this isn't a time of judgment. But if I had the winning numbers to the Florida Lotto, how close would you listen to me? Would you get up here to the front row to make sure you heard me? Would you take out a journal and start to write down in your journal every last word I'm going to say, every number? Would you? All right, well, I'm going to pray. Now, I got something better than lotto numbers. I have something better than earthly treasure this morning to give you. But we need eyes to see. We need ears to hear. And I'm just going to ask you this morning, as I pray, just ask the Lord, Lord, give me ears this morning. Whatever distraction is going on in my life, and I'm sure you have many, because I do too. But this morning, say, God, help me to pay attention. Help me to hear and help this very living word of God to penetrate my heart this morning. All right? Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for you, Lord, this holy God who created everything and sustains everything. We are so thankful that as Christians, we can call this God our Father. Why? Because of the blood of Christ, because of the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus, we can approach the very throne of God and not find judgment and not find wrath, but grace and mercy in our time of need. But Lord, we need you this morning. We need eyes to see and we need ears to hear. And I know a lot of people in this room have a lot going on. There's a lot in their mind. They're trying to figure out if the ham that is in the oven is going to be okay after they get out of church. And there's all of these things, but God, remove any distraction you have from their mind and in their hearts so that they can focus on the living word of God, the very breath of God that is able to save them and transform them for all eternity. So what we know not this morning, teach us. What we are not this morning, make us. And what we have not, give us. Your word is truth. So I ask, Lord Jesus, as you prayed in your high priestly prayer, sanctify us by your truth. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, Amen. If you need a copy of God's Word this morning, we have plenty of Bibles. Just raise your hand and keep it up, and we'll get somebody to get you a Bible if you need one this morning. We have a couple of people. Just keep your hand up, and we'll get you a Bible this morning. And if you don't have a Bible at home, as you're getting this Bible, just keep it. It's our gift to you, okay? There's no greater gift than the living Word of God. That's all you. You can have it. But if you can, take your copy of God's Word and open it to John chapter 20, verse 19. John chapter 20, starting at verse 19. And this morning, really, what we're going to be focusing on is John 20, 19 through 23. That's really all we have time for. If you've been around Restoration long enough, you know I'm long-winded, so I can only get through a few verses at a time. All right? But this is the Word of God. This is what it says. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." So let's get some context of what's going on here. This is the evening of the Sunday that Christ rose from the dead. You see, why do we celebrate Jesus on Sunday? Because Jesus rose on Sunday. Right? The first day of the week. That's why we celebrate. That's why we call Sunday the Lord's Day. It's His day. It's the day He rose. That's why I went from celebrating God on the Sabbath and finding rest on the Sabbath on Saturday to the Sabbath being on Sunday, because Jesus rose on Sunday. That's why we celebrate it on Sunday, every single Sunday, the first day of the week. But this is exactly what is happening. Jesus rose that morning, and now it's evening, and the doors are locked. Earlier that morning, Jesus, we read in our verses, appeared to Mary Magdalene. But now He appears to His 11 disciples. And I want you to notice three things that are happening in this verse. Three things. I want you to notice it. The doors are locked. The disciples are in fear. And Jesus just shows up and stands among them. The doors are locked. The disciples are in fear. And Jesus just stands among them, just shows up. You see, these are three important facts that I believe are extremely relevant before I even get into the promises this morning. I just want to look at the doors being locked for just a second. I want you to notice, my dear friend, that Jesus did not go up to the door and knock at the door. Did He do that? Nope, it's not what He did. The text presumes for us that Jesus didn't need to open the door. So John records for us that Jesus was simply there in the midst of His disciples. And some will say, "Aha, Pastor Arthur, Jesus was a ghost," to which I will reply, "Stop watching so much Ghost Hunters." He was not a ghost. How do you know that? Well, I'm glad somebody asked me this morning. Look at verse 27 of our passage. Jesus provokes Thomas to place his finger on his hands and his hands on his side. These are the wounds from the gruesome crucifixion 3 days earlier. His actual body is there. Luke 24, 39 through 40 records the same account in this way. Luke chapter 24, verses 39 through 40. Jesus says to His disciples, "See my hands." What does he say? "See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself." And then He says, don't just see it, touch me and see. Now, I love this next sentence. This solidifies it for us. "For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." Amen? And when He had said this, what did He do? He showed them His hands and His feet. He wasn't a ghost. Jesus appeared to His disciples in His resurrected body. So what does that mean for us 2,000 years removed from this account? Well, for one thing, my dear friends, this means that Jesus goes where no one else can go. Jesus goes where no one else can go. You see, friend, He can go where no counselor can go. Jesus can go where no doctor can go. Jesus can reach you and reach into you anywhere and at any time. And the truth is that Jesus can meet you exactly where you are this morning, all jacked up. And don't think for a second that you have to get some things right and be tidied up before you can meet with Jesus to do business with God. No siree. Jesus, the living Savior, he can reach into places in your heart that no one else can reach. And he knows that. He knows that very well. So he doesn't wait for you to meet with him. He shows up and meets you where you are. He meets you where you are, worried. He meets you where you are, hurting. He meets you where you are, afraid. This was exactly what the disciples were experiencing, wasn't it? It's the same thing. And many of us who are in this room today are experiencing the very same thing. Look at what verse 19 says. The doors being locked. Where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. You have to understand the context, right? Jesus, their fearless leader, was just crucified. The Romans are looking for them. Who took the body out of that tomb? The Jews are looking for them to exterminate them, to exterminate all of Christianity. All that the disciples had at that moment in that house was fear. Fear. Over the last 2 years, we can amen to that. We have all experienced a great dose of fear, haven't we? Fear from COVID. And the devastating realities that come along with COVID, the death of friends and family members, the fear of dying alone to stop the spreading of a virus, the fear of keeping the lights on in your business. Me and Michelle, we were talking about this. She was running out of eggs. This is the first time somebody's ever told me I'm worried because we're running out of eggs. She had two whole farms bring her eggs. Fear, though, right? Are we going to make it through this pandemic? What are we going to do? Some of us have lost our jobs. How are we going to live? How are we going to survive? Some of us are in fear of being on the right side of history with all the turmoil going on in our culture and in our world. And some of us around the world are in fear of war. And the consequences and the realities that come along with war. I think of Russia and Ukraine. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people who have been displaced from their homes and their families. Fear, real fear. Not knowing if they're ever going to see their loved ones again. Fear of where they're going to live and what they're going to eat. I have a friend who has a ministry in Romania. And he told me, man, there's so many people in fear right now. Fear of what our children are learning and how they will be able to overcome such radical opposition against God and his ordered world. And the truth is I don't have enough time to list all the fears. But we know that list goes on and on and on. And what Jesus is saying to his disciples this morning, and what he's saying to us by appearing to them 2,000 years ago is this: I come to my own when they are afraid. I don't wait for them to get their act together. I don't wait for them to have enough faith to overcome fear. I come to help those who trust in me to have enough faith to overcome fear. And I can testify to this, my dear friends. 14 years later in my Christian walk, there hasn't been one time that I've called out to the name of Jesus that he hasn't come near to me. There hasn't been one time where he has delayed. Maybe not how I thought he was going to come, but he came anyway, and he gave me what I needed. So many times over the last 2 years, I've cried out, Lord, help me, and he has come near. That's just my personal testimony. I love Isaiah 41:10. My children love this verse, which reminds us in our fear that God is near. And it says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And my dear friend, can I submit to you this morning? He can do the same thing for you if you trust him as Lord and Savior this morning. You see, when Jesus came into the midst of his disciples, hear me on this, he was making a very bold statement. You see, it's one thing as a parent to call out to your children from the other room, hey guys, clean your room. Most kids are like, yeah, mom's not going to come, dad's not going to come, so we have some time, right? Any kids in the room, they're like, that's me. And some of you guys are the tap into the Alexa parents, where you know how to get into the Alexa and tell your children, clean your room, clean your room. And the kids are like, yeah, but she's not in the room. But it's a whole other thing, my friends, when the parent busts in the door and he looks them in their eyes with their bodily presence and he says to their children, brush your teeth. Right? That's when the kid says, yeah, yes, dad, I got it. That's the only way my kids will ever brush their teeth is if I show up in their room and remove any distraction. I don't know what it is with children brushing their teeth and taking showers. I don't know. Maybe I'm just failing as a parent. But I have to show up in the room. You see, Jesus didn't come to the house and speak from the other side of the door and deal with them as some have called God, the man upstairs, as some distant deity. No, he didn't interact with them in that way. The resurrected Jesus, he shows up right in their midst because he wasn't playing games with them. He wanted the disciples to see him. He wanted the disciples to know him. He wanted the disciples to believe in him. He wanted the disciples to love him and to give their life to serving him. So he had to show up. And that's really what he wants from us today. And that's what I've been praying for you. I want you to experience the living Jesus, not the ritualistic Jesus just on Sundays. I pray for you to know him. I want you to experience Jesus' drawing near into your life and going where no one else can go. I pray, my dear friends, that you would have him help you in your fears that no one else can help you with. And to have our resurrected Jesus not just simply call you from a distance somewhere up in the sky, but a Jesus who will meet you right here in this room on April 17th, 2022. With all of your failures, with all of your fears, with all of your disappointments. And by the way, if you think that your neighbor isn't as jacked up as you are, well, you don't know them very well. As cleaned up as we look with this nice jacket I just got the other day for Easter Sunday, I'm messed up. The preacher is. I'm in desperate need of God's grace. Can anybody testify that we are desperate for God's grace this morning? So the resurrected Jesus, with that context in mind, comes to us this morning with three promises for those who repent of their sins and believe on Christ for salvation. We've already mentioned them, but I need you to help me with this, okay? He promises what? Peace, power, and purpose. Okay, and now I'm gonna give you the reins to do it on your own. He promises. You guys got it. Praise God. You see, when Jesus makes these promises to his disciples and to us in these verses, don't miss this. He's implying that everyone in the room is dealing with some sort of conflict. They're dealing with some sort of weakness, and they're dealing with some sort of emptiness or hopelessness or aimlessness. What's the opposite of peace? Conflict. What's the opposite of power? Weakness. What's the opposite of purpose? Meaninglessness. You see, my dear friends, many lives in this room have been inflicted and destroyed by conflict, weaknesses, and meaninglessness, if we're honest. So I just want to break maybe the stigma you have about Jesus. Jesus did not come into this world to live for you and to die for you and to be raised for you to ruin your life. He didn't come to ruin your life. He came to save it. Jesus has come to restore you and make you whole. And what you're going to see this morning is that Jesus alone saves us from ruining our own lives. Because some of us know and can say amen if we live long enough. We've messed it up. We've tried it on our own. We haven't got it right. And maybe you're not there yet. Maybe you're in the early stages and you still think, I can do it. You know, when you're young, you feel like you can do it. And when you're old, you're like, I need God. I really do. Jesus alone saves us from ruining our lives. How? By becoming our peace, by becoming our power, and by becoming our purpose. So in verse 19 through 21, Jesus said this to his disciples, and he says this three times in this entire passage. Every time he interacts with his disciples, he starts with this, peace be with you. It's interesting. Peace be with you. You see, Jesus in his sovereignty understands that peace must be established before he mentions power and purpose. You see, friends, the peace that Jesus gives is before and underneath any of our empowered actions and purposeful deeds. And this is something that the preacher has to preach to himself all the time. All the time. Peace comes first, Pastor Arthur. This is something that the preacher has to preach to the congregation every single week. Peace comes first with God. It's really a gospel issue, right? We must come to an understanding that we do not initiate peace with God by our actions or our good deeds. Rather, it is by Christ alone, the Son of God. He alone initiates peace with us broken sinners. So you have to get this. This is the crux of the gospel. There is no peace with God by our own merits. Because we are born with sin and all of our merits are filled with sin. The Bible calls them filthy rags. There is no peace with God by our own merits. So Jesus, by his grace, reaches down into the darkness of our hearts. And he has to make us alive with him to have peace with God. Listen to what the Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 2. He says this. For he himself, Jesus, is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in the flesh the dividing wall of hostility, so making peace, and so that he might reconcile us both to God in one body, how? Through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. First and foremost, Jesus has accomplished a peace for us with God that we could never accomplish on our own. Let me say that again because I want to make sure you get this, okay? First and foremost, Jesus has accomplished a peace for us with God that we could never accomplish on our own. And this is exactly why Jesus, listen to me here, this is exactly why in verse 20, Jesus looks to his disciples and he says, hey, look at my hands and look at my side when he appeared to them. Why did he do that? Because by showing them his hands and his side, he is saying to his disciples, I'm the one who died. I'm the one you abandoned. I'm the one who was pierced for your transgressions. Isaiah 53:5. And he's saying to them by showing his hands in his side, the reason that I can offer you peace with a holy God today is because of the blood that I have shed for you to cover all of your sins. And if you trust me, Jesus is saying this morning, if you trust me, all of your sins won't be held against you before a holy God. Y'all get what that means? He's telling them by showing his hands and his side that because of me, the wrath of God will be turned away on you. I thought y'all would be more excited about that. But that's exactly what Paul meant when he said, Christ reconciled us both to God. How? Through the cross, thereby killing the hostility between us and God. So you have to get what this means. All the hostility between God and us was absorbed on the cross. So Jesus says, hey, friends, look at my side and look at my hands. Look at my side and look at my hands. I've made peace with these. The justice of a holy God was satisfied with these. Peace between you and God and me was established with these. That's why he showed it to him. Hey, you want to touch it? By the way, me and my brother were talking. Thomas never actually touched his wounds. He just needed to see them. And that's when he bowed down and worshiped him. That's just a side note. He offers us peace this morning. The crucified and the risen Jesus this morning, I want to submit to you, brings peace into our life in five ways. If you trust him today in five ways. So listen closely, right? This is better than the lottery numbers, remember? So listen up. First of all, he brings peace between us and him. And this is the most obvious meaning, right? Jesus is standing there among the disciples, offering them what? Himself as their judge? No, as their friend and as their helper and as their peace. So that's the first thing. He brings peace between us and him. Second, he brings peace between us and God. That's why God sent his son, you know, so that God's justice and God's wrath could be satisfied another way besides our eternal punishment. You see, God makes peace with us. How? By substituting his son's suffering for our penalty. And those this morning who trust in Christ as their peace, y'all have to hear me. This makes you hoot and holler. God comes to you not as a judge, but as a loving father. He brings peace between us and him. He brings peace between us and God. Thirdly, he brings peace between us and others who are in Christ. You see, to be reconciled to God is to be reconciled to all who are reconciled to God. This is what I love about the church. This is why the church is so important right here. Because in the church, there shouldn't be any hostility, vertically or horizontally. And I know what you're thinking. Oh, man, I've been to churches and there definitely is. You know, it is. But that's because we're broken, and this place is a hospital. So we don't quite got it all together, but this is the aim. You see, in the church, there's no other place, there's no other organization, not the YMCA or Planet Fitness. Nobody else can offer this kind of peace. In the church, there is no racism. In the church, there is no ethnocentrism or classism or sexism or any other kind of isms that they have out there. When Paul wrote to the church at Galatia, he said this, here in the church, y'all, here among Christians is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Amen. He brings us peace between he and us. He brings us peace between us and God. And he brings peace between us and our own souls. And this is a very important one. The New Testament letter to the Hebrews says this in Hebrews 9. The blood of Christ will purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God. This is such an important point, my dear friends. Don't let this pass you by. And y'all know this. Oh, the precious peace of a clear conscience. How many people in this room, if we were honest, have been laboring under the misery and defiled and guilty conscience? How many of you are living under a defiled and guilty conscience this morning? And I'm sure there are many who are here today who are saying to themselves right now, Pastor Arthur, I can't forgive myself. And to you, I want to tell you, I want to encourage you. That's what Good Friday was for. That's what Good Friday was for. Christ has come to forgive you and to give your soul peace this morning. Peace this morning for your soul. You see, peace with yourself, I do want you to know this, doesn't mean that you start seeing your past sins as desirable. Peace doesn't mean that past sins cease to be painful. But when you trust in the Lord Jesus as your peace this morning, all of your past, all of the guilt, all of those sins cease to paralyze you. The pain in your life may not be taken away immediately, but the penalty is taken away instantly through Christ the moment you believe in Him. I want you to know this, my dear friend. If I know maybe you feel like you haven't forgiven yourself, but Christ, if you believe on Him today, He has forgiven you. Christ and Christ alone makes it possible for all of us who are broken to heal. Christ and Christ alone makes it possible for us to move on with a hope-filled life while we heal, while we become restored in Christ. And the last kind of peace that Jesus offers us is peace with the world. You see, when Jesus died, He did what needed to be done so that someday in the future, in God's time, all evil will be cast out into utter darkness and the entire new creation will be full of peace and righteousness. I do want you to understand something, right? We always celebrate Advent, but I'm looking forward to the second Advent where Jesus is coming back. Y'all, when Jesus comes back, I want you to know what's going to happen, okay? Isaiah 9:7, it says, of the increase of His government and of peace, there will be, y'all going to help me preach? There will be no end on the throne of David and over His kingdom to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. For He shall reign forever and ever. Yeah, come on, let's give Him a shout. He shall reign forever and ever. I want you to hear the words of Jesus this morning out of John 16:33. Jesus says this to us this morning. I have said these things to you. Why, Jesus? That in Me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But y'all ready? But take heart. I have overcome the world. That's what the resurrection is about, isn't it? He's overcome the world. Jesus alone gives us peace with Him, peace with God the Father, peace with others in Christ, peace with ourselves, and peace with the world. You see, this is why the resurrection is such an amazing achievement, isn't it? It has accomplished much, but the big question for us this morning is how do we receive this promise of peace? How do we receive this, Pastor Arthur? Well, Ephesians chapter 2 says this. This is how you receive it. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. Here it is. By grace you have been saved. Unmerited favor from God. Then He says in verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith in Christ. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of any of your works, so that no one may boast. And I know that some of you are thinking, why is it so hard for people to receive gifts? Because some gifts are hard to receive. I often give an example of a spouse trying to give their spouse, you know, 10 ways on how they can lose weight for Christmas, a magazine. If you give that to your wife, what are you implying? Or to your husband? They need to lose weight, right? So by receiving the gift, you're like, hey, hold on a second. What are you saying? You have to admit that you need to lose weight to receive that book, 10 Ways on How to Lose Weight. So sometimes it's hard to receive grace because we have to confess that we're sinners. That's hard. You get this glorious peace when you accept the free gift of God's grace, but this morning you have to receive it. There's no earning it. There's no attaining it. It's a gift given by God that must be received by grace through faith. And this morning, you can do one of two things. You can receive this gift of grace or walk away from it. Or maybe we can put it this way. We can either receive Christ or we can walk away from Him and reject God's gift of grace. But this morning, if you want real peace, everlasting peace, you have to repent of your sins. You have to confess that you're a sinner in need of grace. And you need to confess this morning, I need Jesus to forgive me of my sins and give me eternal life. You have to admit this morning that you are at odds with God. And the only one who can reconcile you is Jesus through His life and through His death and through His resurrection. And the beauty of Scripture that if we receive Jesus, if we receive this gift of grace, here's what John 1 tells us. To all who did receive Him, who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God. Romans 5:1 says this, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus offers you this morning this gift of grace. I offer it to you on His behalf. It's free, and I hope you receive it. So we've spent a lot of time in the promise of peace. Sorry, but not sorry. Because it's really the foundation of the other promises. You see, the truth is that if we don't have peace with God, we will take all of the other promises and try to use them to make peace with God. That's the kind of thing we do. That's the way our sinful nature is bent. So we must always start with the promise of peace. Everything else in the Christian walk is the effect of this peace with God in Christ. The best way that you can remember it before I move on to the power is this. Peace is the root and everything else is the fruit. Peace is the root. Everything else is the fruit. But not only does Jesus bring peace in our passage this morning, but quickly, He brings us promise, or He brings us power and purpose. He gives us power and purpose. Here's what He says in verse 21. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I'm sending you. That's the purpose. And when He had said this, He breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. That's power. Now let me show you a very similar reading in Acts 1:8. Jesus says, but you will receive what? Power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses. That this is the purpose, right? You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So what's the power? The Holy Spirit. What's the purpose? To tell the world who Christ is and what He's done for us. And here's the bottom line. We can't accomplish the purpose of Christ without His Holy Spirit. You see, the God we serve is triunal. That means that God is one. We believe in a monotheistic God. God is one in three distinct persons with equal essence and with equal power. Believing in the Trinity is very important. And each person of the Trinity has a specific purpose in our salvation. So we can remember the Trinity this way in salvation. The Father chose us, the Son redeemed us, and the Spirit regenerates us. And what I love about the Holy Spirit is that He also sanctifies us and empowers us to carry out this great purpose, this great commission. You see, my dear friends, the Holy Spirit gives those He makes spiritually alive this morning the power to do what we are simply unable to do on our own. You see, Jesus didn't leave you and me as orphans in a broken world to carry out this great mission. But the resurrection promises to us that the Holy Spirit, He will come. He will empower us to live for Him and to be witnesses for Him. You see, the Christian no longer lives by his own strength. But he lives by embracing his weaknesses so that Christ, through the Holy Spirit, might perfect His power in us. I love 2 Corinthians because this challenges so much of our secular worldview. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 defines the Christian life this way. This is Jesus in response to Paul when Paul asked Jesus to remove a thorn from his side, some sort of affliction. And Jesus responds to Paul this way, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in strength. Is that what it says? No, in weakness. So Paul's response is this, if that's the case, Jesus, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with my weaknesses and insults and hardships and persecution and calamities, because I've realized, for when I am weak, then I am strong. This is completely upside down from the world, by the way. And that's why, this is why so many of us who are here today are tired. You are weary of plowing through life by your own strength. And today, if that's you, if you're weary, if you're tired of trying to plow through life by your own abilities, by your own strength, Jesus says to you, come to me. All who labor and are heavy laden, all those who've been trying to do it on their own, come to me and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. I'm gentle. I'm lowly in heart. And for all the weary souls in this place, he says to you, if you come to me, you will find rest for your souls. And if you yoke yourself up against me and stop trying to do it on your own, you will find that my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is marvelous. This is what I like to call the glorious exchange. This morning, when you come to Jesus and you give him your weaknesses in exchange, he gives you his power through his Holy Spirit. This morning, when you come to Jesus and you give him your burdens, he gives you his rest in his Spirit. Praise God. And some of you are thinking, Pastor Arthur, I'm afraid of giving my life to Jesus. I'm afraid of what that will mean and what that might entail. Pastor Arthur, I'm afraid that I won't get it right. I don't want to be a hypocrite, Pastor Arthur. And to that response, I'm going to say this. I completely understand that. I get where you're coming from. But I want you to hear the words of Jesus in response to that. Jesus says this in John 14, these things I have spoken to you while I'm still with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he's going to teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. And he tells you, my dear friend, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives. So this is important because he's saying you can't find this kind of peace anywhere else in the world. You can try, you won't find it. Not as the world gives do I give to you. So here's what he's telling you this morning. Let not your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid. Come this morning and the Holy Spirit will be your helper in this hard life. Come this morning and the Holy Spirit, he will guide you. Come this morning and he will be your comforter. Come to Christ this morning and he will be your power to live for him and be witnesses for him. So now I close with this last promise of purpose. He says this in verse 20, as the Father has sent me, even so I'm sending you. See, Jesus has come to give everyone a purpose that goes beyond this life alone, beyond any bachelor's degree, master's degree, or PhD. This is a purpose so big that only the Holy Spirit, God himself, can carry out through us. He says, as the Father has sent me to preach peace with God, hey, church, I'm going to send you to preach peace with God. I'm going to use you to be a light in this dark world. I'm going to use you to be truth in a world that's perverse and wicked and evil. I'm going to send you to preach the good news that I have come to do what no one else did before. I'm going to use you to preach the gospel that has the power to save the lost. I'm going to use you to preach the gospel that has the power to set the captives free. You're dealing with addiction. He can break that. I'm going to use you as witnesses to preach the gospel that has the power to restore anybody that is broken. You see, this is amazing because Jesus uses his church to do what no doctor can do. And we revere the doctors and we revere the lawyers as we should. But man, our purpose in Christ is so much greater. And so if you ask me, my dear friends, here's what I would tell you about what he said in verse 21. You see, Jesus did not appear to his disciples on Sunday evening so that you can sleep in on Monday morning. You see, what we do tomorrow, what we do after this church service is why Jesus showed up to his followers. So let me talk to his believers right now. All the Christians in the room, I want to talk to you for just a second. Friends, Jesus did not appear on Sunday evening to his disciples so that we will... Listen, y'all got to get this. He didn't show up on Sunday evening for us not to show up at our friend's door on Monday morning. He wants to use you. Jesus wants to use your life and your career and your family and your interests to spread the gospel that whoever believes in Christ should not perish but have eternal life. So I close with Matthew 28 this morning that leaves us with all three promises, the promise of peace, power, and purpose. This is what he says to his disciples. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. That's power. He says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. That's purpose. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. That's peace. So this morning, I have a question for you. What are you going to do with what you heard this morning? If you've never placed your faith in Christ for the forgiveness of sin and salvation, what are you going to do with this Jesus? Because what you do with Jesus is going to impact eternal life. And this morning, if you've never confessed faith in Christ, if you've never repented of your sins and trusted Jesus for the forgiveness of sins and eternal life, this morning, in just a second, I'm going to have some of our leadership down here just come up to them and say, I want to follow Jesus today. I want to take a step. And for the Christian, I want to remind you that Jesus didn't save you so you can sleep in tomorrow. Jesus saved you and sent his Holy Spirit to live in you so you could go out on Monday and tell the world that Jesus lives. To tell the world that he's not in the tomb. To tell the world that he is ruling and reigning. To tell the world that there is a provision for sin. To tell the world that anybody who believes in Christ can have eternal life. Don't waste your life. Don't waste your life. No matter what your career is, use it to the glory of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word that reminds us this morning of the resurrection. That reminds us this morning that because Jesus lives, we can face tomorrow. That reminds us this morning that God, you saved us on purpose for a purpose. That reminds us this morning that there is a peace that can only be found in Christ that can't be found anywhere else. Not in a beer bottle, not in prescription pills, not in achievements, not in accolades, not in our ambitions, not in our careers. There is a peace that is in Christ that is unlike any peace that the world can offer. Jesus alone offers us peace with God. And right now, I want our leadership to come down to the front. Let's get a woman and a man to come down. This morning, I just want to challenge you if I can. Ashley, if you can come up here for a second. Right now, I want you to take a step, if that's you. If you've never trusted in Christ for salvation. If you've never believed on the Lord Jesus for salvation. I want you to come on up here to somebody in the front row and say, Pastor Arthur, or whoever you're going to talk to, and say, I want to take a step of faith. I want to trust Christ as my King and as my Lord. Come on up. This decision is the most important decision you have to make ever. Eternity hangs in the balance this morning. Hey, listen, we don't need any fancy music to be in the background. We don't need the lights to be turned off. We believe if you're going to make a decision, you're going to do it in the light because you surely won't do it in the dark. So let's do it right now. If that's you, if you trusted in Christ or if you want to trust in Christ, come on up. And lastly, I just want to pray now for our Christians in the room. Lord, thank you for this assurance. Thank you for this reminder, God, that you live. Thank you, God, that you reminded us this day, this Resurrection Sunday, April 17th, 2022, that you live. And because you live, you offer us peace for our souls. Because you live, you give us the power of the Holy Spirit. And because you live, you give us a purpose that transcends all other purposes. God, may we be a missional people. God, may we not be a people who are silent. May we not be quiet of the things that we have heard and the things that we have seen and the things that we have tasted. May we go out and tell the world that Jesus lives and that he offers us peace in himself. Lord, we love you and we pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Keep praying if you're praying. Keep praying. Let's stand to our feet if we can this morning. And I want to challenge you this morning to something. There's no better way to celebrate Resurrection Sunday with spiritual new life in Christ. And so this morning, I think there's a slide back there. If you have a baptism slide, Thomas, it should be the last by the benediction. Is it up there? All right, there's Julie. Miss Julie, right after service, we're going to get set up. Praise God. Just a few weeks ago, Julie gave her life to Christ, and today we're going to baptize her in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I don't think there's a better way to celebrate new life or to celebrate the resurrection power than celebrate new life in Christ. Amen. So I'm going to let us read the benediction together, and then let us meet outside, okay? Let us meet outside as we baptize Miss Julie today. I'm so excited for you. Let us read this benediction together this morning out of Peter. Let us read it together. Is it on the screen? If it's on the screen, say amen. Let us read it. By the Holy Spirit, may we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Christ be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. See you outside, church.